Hello and welcome once again to our special presentation from inside the Parliament House complex, the show Question Hour, in which we bring you the questions, the unstarred ones, which have been asked by the members of the Parliament and replied to in written by the government. So the first 15 minutes will be me and my colleague Kriti Mishra, who will give you the details of some important questions from a few ministries which were asked by the members of the Parliament. And then after the break, our colleagues Arvind Singh and Akhilesh Suman will bring you the same the questions in Prashn Kala as well. So let's begin, Kriti. And this particular 15-minute segment will have questions from ministries like agriculture, railways and communication. So let's begin the first one from the agriculture, wherein one of the members, Ripun Bora, goes on to ask the government whether it is a fact that farmer suicides in the country has risen by 50% in 2018 in comparison to last 2 years, and also whether more than 640 farmers have committed suicides in 3 months from March to May 2018 in Maharashtra alone.
Well, that's a hotly debated issue, Vishal, and Purushottam Rupala, who is MOS Agriculture, has given this answer, and he says that the number of suicide by farmers and agricultural labourers during 2016 has come down approximately by 9.77% from 12,602 to 11,370 as compared to suicides in the year 2015. In the state of Maharashtra, the number of suicides by farmers and agricultural labourers during 2015 was 4,291, while in the year 2016 it was 3,661, which is approximately 14.68% less as compared to the year 2015. Agriculture, including agricultural indebtedness, being a state subject, the state governments are primarily responsible for the growth and development of agriculture sector and developing prospective plans for their respective states and ensuring effective implementation of the programs and schemes. However, Government of India supplements the efforts of the state governments through various schemes and programs.
Well, quite a detailed answer there from the government, Kriti.
That's right, Vishal. So the next question has been asked by Ravi Prakash Verma, and he asks whether it is a fact that government has failed to provide remunerative prices to farmers of the country while the cost of production has gone up rapidly and prices of crops have gone down drastically since 2015.
Well, this one again is to the Ministry of Agriculture, and here also the minister concerned, Purushottam Rupala, goes on to answer this one by saying that minimum support price, or the MSP, is notified for both Kharif and Rabi crops based on the recommendations of the Commission on Agriculture Costs and Prices, that is CACP. Now, the Commission collects and analyzes data on cost of cultivation and recommends the MSP. Giving a major boost for the farmers' income, the government has increased the MSP of all Kharif crops for 2018 and 19 season. Now, the decision of the government is a historic one, as it redeems the promise of the predetermined principle of fixing the MSPs at a level of at least 150% of the cost of production announced by the Union Budget for 2018-2019. So clearly the minister is pointing out the fact that MSP has been increased by the government in tandem with the promise which was made by the concerned minister as well as the Prime Minister.
And the government has maintained that this decision is a historic one.
Well, yes, indeed. The next one, Kriti, is from the member Muhammad Fayaz, who goes on to say the welfare schemes by the central government for the farmers who suffered losses due to natural calamities. So clearly the member here is asking for all the welfare schemes which have been launched by the government.
That's right, Vishal. So Gajendra Singh Shekhawat, who's MOS Agriculture, has given this answer, and he goes on to say that the Department of Agriculture, Cooperation and Farmers Welfare is concerned with providing relief under NDRF to farmers who have lost their crops due to drought, hailstorm, pest attack and cold wave or frost. An amount of 22,000 crore rupees has been approved by NDRF during 2015-16 to 2017-18 to the states affected by the above said calamities. The Government of India has evolved several schemes, programs to address the need for drought mitigation and other requirements of the farmers under Rashtriya Krishi Vikas Yojana, Pradhan Mantri Krishi Sichai Yojana. Besides implementation of Pradhan Mantri Fasal Bima Yojana and National Agriculture Market Scheme for protecting the interests of farmers. Moving on to the Ministry of Chemicals and Fertilizers now. So MB Rajiv Gowda of the Congress has asked whether high GST rates on chemical inputs for fertilizers have impacted their domestic production.
Well, quite an important one here, Kriti, again, because this pertains to the agriculture sector. And The minister, Rao Inderjeet Singh, goes on to answer this question by saying there are 31 urea manufacturing units in the country, out of which 28 use natural gas as feedstock, while 3 urea units use naphtha. Now, the natural gas is out of the purview of goods and services tax, that is GST. Naphtha and furnace oil, which are used as raw material for producing urea, are levied 18% GST, and the urea units get benefit of input tax credit. Now, post implementation of GST, that is with effect from 1st of July 2017, the production of urea was 14.98 LMT in 2017-18, whereas it was 14.11 LMT in 2016-17. The production of P and K fertilizers during the year 2016-17 and 2017-18 were 172.39 LMT and 173.39 LMT respectively. Accordingly, GST rates have not impacted domestic production of fertilizers. So the facts are pretty much clear there, that there has been no reduction in the production of fertilizers vis-a-vis the rate, the GST, which
is
coming
to effect. That's a huge breather, Vishal.
Well, the next one, Kriti, is from Dheeraj Prasad Sahu, who goes on to ask the government whether the Coal India Limited, that is CIL, proposes to set up new coal washeries in the country.
Well, Coal Minister Piyush Goyal has given the answer, and he says that Coal India Limited proposes to set up as many as 18 new coal washeries, 9 coking coal and 9 non-coking coal in the country. 11 of them are proposed to be set up in Jharkhand, 8 for coking coal and 3 for non-coking coal. The coal washing will improve the quality of domestic coal by reducing ash content and improving calorific value of the coal. Certainly a very important answer given there by the coal minister, Vishal.
Well, yes, indeed.
Now, moving on to the next question, and this one pertains to the Ministry of Law and Justice. So Mahesh Poddar of the BJP has asked whether it is a fact that there is a possibility of manifold reduction in the number of pending litigations if rural courts are established at panchayat level.
Well, this is something which has been thought about by the government for quite some time, and the Minister of State for Law and Justice, P.P. Chaudhary, goes on to answer this question by saying that to provide access to justice to the citizens at their doorsteps, the central government has enacted the Gram Nyayalayas Act 2008. Now, it provides for the establishment of Gram Nyayalayas at intermediate panchayat level. The state governments are responsible for establishing Gram Nyayalayas in consultation with the respective high courts. As per information made available by state governments and high courts, 343 such Gram Nyayalayas have been notified so far by 11 states. Out of these, 210 are operational in 9 states. So clearly, there are a number of rural courts which are functional. And for more on this, we did speak to the member concerned, Mahesh Poddar, who posed this question to the government a short while back.
That's right, Vishal. So Mr. Mahesh Poddar is joining us right now. Sir, to your question, the government has given a very elaborate answer on how it is improving the access of citizens to justice.
Yeah, government has given that, and I personally believe that, as an old saying, that justice delayed is justice denied. So there are number of cases pending all over, in all kind of cases, criminal cases, civil cases, even the family cases, and it takes a lot of time. So I had asked this question, that what they are doing about it, why can't we resolve many of the smaller minor cases in different platforms. So government has given that information, and it is the numbers are startling.
Mm-hmm. That's right. So how satisfied are you with the answer?
So I am satisfied with the answer, but two things has emerged out of it, that the judicial matters, our judicial courts or resolution of the judicial issues are basically in the hands of the high courts, panchayat courts, gram panchayat courts. Even those matters are with the high courts, and they have to take a call, because the last meeting they had was in 2013, and a good number of years have passed and nothing has moved much. The only few states have that, only few number of courts have that, and in the meantime, the number of cases in the lower court has gone up to almost 2.75 crores. That's something really one has to worry about.
The government also talks about strengthening the justice system at the panchayat level.
Yeah, it is panchayat level. See, the not only panchayat level, I'd say that there was a system of resolutions and solving these issues even with the family members, many of the most of the issues of the social nature, family nature, were resolved in the family courts, I would say. I mean, not the formal courts, but the formal, informal people, panchayats, and the seniors, where the elders were respected, and they were resolving these issues. But now those institutions have vanished, or they have become sort of unfunctioning. They are not functioning well. So these formal courts have taken over. So these courts have a process to follow, and basically they are not only costly, they are lengthy also. So they have to find some solution.
Point well taken. Thank you so much for talking to Ratsabha Television and sharing your views.
So that was BJP MP Mahesh Poddar, who posed that question about the rural courts to the government. Moving on to the next one, which has been asked by the member K.R. Arjunan, and that is to the Ministry of Communications. The member says whether it is a fact that the Inter-Ministerial Telecom Commission cleared the Telecom Regulatory Authority of India's suggestion on net neutrality that bars service providers from discriminating against internet content and services by blocking, throttling, or granting them higher speed access. The net neutrality issue, Kriti, is once again in the center stage as of now.
That's right. It has been in the public domain for quite some time now. And Telecom Minister Manoj Sinha answers that Telecom Commission, in its meeting held on 11th of July 2018, has granted its approval to the recommendations of TRAI on net neutrality with minor modifications upholding the principles of net neutrality. The government is committed to the fundamental principles and concept of net neutrality and strives for non-discriminatory access to internet for all citizens of the country. To ensure that the regulatory framework adheres to the fundamental principles and concepts of net neutrality, the policy directives on net neutrality have been issued, incorporating the principles of non-discriminatory treatment of content. So certainly a very important answer there by the government,
Vishal.
Moving on, Kumari Shalja has asked about the details of employment generated through business processes outsourcing operations, particularly in the rural areas.
Well, Kriti, to this, the minister concerned goes on to say that the BPO or the BPM sector accounts for a total employment of 11.52 lakh out of the total employment of 39,68,000 in the IT BPO or BPM sector in financial year 2017-18, an increase of about 6% from 10.86 lakhs in the financial year 2016-17. Now, the government has launched India BPO Promotion Scheme, that is IBPS, and Northeast BPO Promotion Scheme, that is NEBPS, under Digital India Program, with the aim to incentivize setting up of BPO or BPM operations across the country, particularly in small towns and cities, including rural areas, to create employment opportunities, promote dispersal of the industry, and tap local infrastructure and talent pool. So as far as the figures are concerned, they clearly point out that there has been an increase in the employment generated through the BPOs at the rural level as well.
Which is very inspiring, no doubt.
Well, the next one and the last one for this segment is from the Ministry of Railways. And in this question, the member goes on to ask whether it is a fact that the railways have introduced electronic mechanism on railway systems to monitor the actual running of the trains.
Well, the answer is a very riveting one, and the government says that Railways has implemented control office application in the year 2009 in all divisional and area control offices of Indian Railways for electronic capturing and monitoring of the actual running of trains. Progressive implementation of computerization of train signal register at 650 stations is a step further in electronically mechanizing operations. Automated data updation is also being done through data received from data loggers, which have been integrated at 72 stations of Indian Railways. That's a novel piece of information, Vishal.
Well, yes, indeed. And that information also gives us a look into as to how this particular system monitors the train movement and can give us the information.
So those were the important questions asked by the members of the Rajya Sabha and the answers given by the government. So that's all Vishal and I had for you in this edition of Question Hour. Prashan Kaul with our colleagues Arvind Singh and Akhilesh Suman on the other side. Stay tuned.